Turn your Bibles, please, to Genesis chapter 3. Boy, we're just cruising, aren't we? We are cruising. We're into chapter 3, and we got in a piece of it. We're going to get in a little more of chapter 3 tonight. You know, last week we studied basically the original sin, guys. The original sin, that disobedience that took place by God's creation, Adam and Eve, going against God's word and what God had told them. Adam and Eve both were disobedient and disobedient to God's word. What seems so minor, you think about it, you know, that little thing had historical and eternal consequences for mankind totally. It was such a little thing, one little rebellion of God's word, what he had told them, one little bite of that fruit, you know, and sin was born. You know, so many people think, they say, well, it was an apple. It never says an apple. We don't know what that fruit is. I have no idea what that fruit was. Maybe it was a special fruit, one of a kind, right? I don't know. But anyway, that one little bite and sin was born. Sin of man, forever established within the seed of man. Do you understand? Forever established. Adam and Eve, oh man, they missed the mark. They missed the bullseye, sin. The word sin comes from an old archer's term. And anything outside that exact perfect bullseye was to sin. So when they would shoot their arrows and they missed anything outside of that was sin. They missed the mark. They were way off perfection. That's how little it had to be, that little bite. Mankind would be forever missing the mark from now on, missing the mark of perfection by all means. You know, as hard as we try, guys, as hard as we try, we could lock ourselves in a room somewhere. We could, you know, only come out to get a little food. As hard as we try, we miss the mark because of that original sin. You know, Satan's lie to Eve there in verse 4. If you look at verse 4 that we read last week, then the serpent said to the woman, Eve, you will not surely die. Now she had told Satan, or the serpent actually, told him, well, God said, don't eat from that. Do not eat from that or you will surely die. And, oh, Satan, he says to Eve, you won't surely die. Created doubt in her mind, church. You understand? Created this doubt. A doubt in Eve's mind and a doubt of God, too. That's what Satan did. Satan's so good at it. Satan's tactics never change. He put doubt in her mind. A doubt to even the badness of sin. What would one little bite do, you know? What's one little bite? How bad could sin be? The doubt of the goodness of God, too. Doubted God's goodness. Satan, as I say, never changes his tactics. He does the same thing over and over, and it works when they can create doubt. Turn your Bibles, if you would, to James. James speaks about doubt in an awesome way. I love it. You know, I love James because to me, maybe because I'm just a man, but he speaks so direct, like straight up. Don't beat around the bush. Here it is, you know. I love that. You know, God's word needs to do that with us. Just don't beat around the bush. In James chapter 1, beginning in verse 5, James writes, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God. Guys, you lack any wisdom? You need to know for a situation? Well, what does James say? Ask of God. Would you just ask, please? Just ask. And it says, he who gives to all liberally, he'll give you it with abundance. You just ask for it. You need some wisdom. And without any type of reproach, and it will be given to him, he says. But, let him ask in faith, in trust, in believing, right? In faith with no doubting. For he who doubts is like a wave of the sea, driven and tossed by the wind. Boy, isn't that something? You know, what a good analogy that is. A wave of the sea just going everywhere. That's he who doubts. For let let not that man suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord, because he's a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. You see, that's the doubt. That's the doubt that God doesn't want us to have. We have to be rock solid in our faith. See, when man doubts God, you understand, nothing's out of bounds. When we doubt God and His Word and what He tells us, then nothing's out of bounds. Man's own will now becomes the truth. What we think, right? What we think. God becomes kind of that null and void, I want to say, when we doubt God and we doubt His Word. Man does what is right and what is wrong, all in his own eyes. Remember last week I used this scripture, and I've used it quite a bit. It's the truth, and it's the truth for our country today, guys. It's really the truth for the whole world, but it's definitely the truth for America. So I'm going to change it, not in those days, in Judges 21:25, but in these days. I'm going to say in these days. There was no king in Israel. There's no King Jesus in these days. Everyone did what was right in his own eyes. Boy, is that what we see in our country? Absolutely. What's right for me, it's okay. Because, you know what? There is no God. There is no king. Now, Satan's tactics, as I say, they always work. They work then. And the tactic, though, he used with Eve, he had some truth in it, right? Because then he tells her the eyes would be opened, right? In verse 5, he said, for God knows that in the day you eat of it, your eyes will be opened. He's telling some truth. Guys, that's what Satan does. Many times he tells some truth, makes it sound good, and it actually has some truth in it, but then there's a total lie. Do you understand? So he said, the serpent said to the woman, you will not surely die, for God knows that in the day you eat of it, your eyes will be open and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. Well, there was some truth, all right. Yes, Adam and Eve's eyes were opened. Absolutely, they were opened. And they will be opened. Open to their own sin, open to their own rebellion, you see. It was open. Sin was born and their eyes were open. Much like in James 1:15, use this scripture a lot too. Then when desire has conceived, what does it do? It gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is full grown, brings forth death. Boy, are we going to see it brings forth death for them too. You shall not surely die. Yes, you will. But your eyes will be open. Oh, by the way, that's true. You're going to be like God? No, you're not. See, Satan's in his lies. Satan's tactics, guys, do not change. Understand that. Man's sin does not change either. Consequences do not change for sin. There is consequences. Sin brings forth death, as it says in James, and as God told Adam and Eve. See, Adam and Eve now, they both ate, right? They both ate. They both partook of it. They both rebelled. In verse 7, then the eyes of both of them were opened. Both Adam and Eve were opened. And they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves coverings. You know, I mentioned that last week. They chose the worst leaf in the world because that fig leaf has little prickers on it, you know, little prickly things. And so you're covering up that area with something that's going to be kind of itchy. But anyway, they did this. Both their eyes were open. They were open to sin, church. They were open to their own shame. Do you understand? Satan's word were true right there. Yeah, their eyes were open. Eyes were open to the sin they had committed. Satan's words, like I say, they were also a lie when he said, well, you'll be like God. No, no. God's eyes, guys, God's eyes are open, right? He's going to say, because your eyes are open, you're going to be like God. No, God's eyes are open. He sees all the rebellion that's taken place. Trust me, God sees and knows and is not surprised at what's going on in our world today. God knows that He sees all the rebellion. He sees all the sin. See, God's actions, though, have no sin. Anything God does has no sin involved in it. God is righteous, and we must know that in all things. In all things. Jesus, God's Son, knew no sin. Remember in prayer I said, He knew no sin. That is doctrine. We have to understand that deep within us. Can we imagine that? Can we imagine it? No, if we look at mankind, we're talking man-God. Jesus Christ. He had no sin, knew no sin, and he became sin for us upon the cross. 2 Corinthians 5:21, for he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become, what? The righteousness of God in him. Without Jesus, we have no righteousness. With Jesus, we are covered in his righteousness before God. God looks at you as though you have done nothing wrong because you're covered with the blood of Jesus. He says, you'll be like God. Oh, no. You're going to receive a curse, actually, Adam, Eve, from God. A curse that will be the penalty of that sin, and probably the largest of it is death. See, there would be death in the world now. There would be death. A curse for Adam, a curse for Eve. Oh, by the way, a curse from that serpent too, that rascally serpent. Just a curse for rebellion in all ways. Let's pray, and we're going to get into a nice message. Father God, we just thank you, Lord. Father, that you, again, you will just teach us through your word. As we study your word, Lord, speak to our hearts. God, you always want to teach us something. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So the title of my message tonight is Cursed Sin. Oh, that cursed sin, guys. You ever get tired of it? I know I do. Just cursed sin. In verse 8, let's go on here. We're backing up a little bit, and then we'll go into where we were. And they heard the sound of the Lord walking in the garden. So they'd sinned, right? They put all these leaves, fig leaves, sewed them together and wearing them. And then they heard the sound of the Lord walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife, they hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. Then the Lord God called to them, Adam, and said, hey, where are you? Where are you, Adam? He didn't have to call. He knows where he's at. But the fact of the matter, God calls, where are you? Now, it says they heard the sound of the Lord walking. Heard that sound. They knew exactly who it was. They knew exactly who it was, no doubt. This occurred daily for them. Do you guys understand? God would go down in fellowship with Adam and Eve daily. This wasn't something that was new. And so they knew that sound of God walking through there. Each day, God would spend time with Adam, would spend time with Eve in fellowship, you know, walk down there and speak to them and you know, fellowship with them and probably maybe eat a little something too. God would just hang out down there. How wonderful that is. Do we spend time with God? Does your life just get so busy? You don't take the time just to fellowship with God? God was fellowshipping with them, daily fellowship with the Lord. It says they heard the sound of the Lord walking. Now, I want to show you something here. Guys, we can assume this one who is walking is God in the person of Jesus Christ walking in the garden. It's what you call a Christophany. Many places in the Old Testament, you will see what they call Christophanies, and that's the pre-incarnate appearance of Jesus. He was in the beginning, right? Father, Son, Holy Spirit. He was from the beginning. Now, why do I see that? Well, in John 1:18, no one has seen God at any time, the Father. The only begotten Son who is in the bosom of the Father, he has declared him, right? And many places too. God is spirit. The Father is spirit. Jesus took on that, obviously, as a man when he was incarnate of a virgin. But before that, you see what you call Christophanies. No man has seen God. When Moses spoke to God, he was speaking to a burning bush. There was nobody else standing there. When other prophets would speak to God, they would not see God himself. In verse 9, we roll on here, and it says, then the Lord called to Adam and said to him, where are you? Where are you, Adam? Where are you? Now, he wasn't some kind of anger that God spoke here, some kind of anguish. Where'd you go, Adam? Hey, I lost him, you know. It wasn't in some kind of anguish. God knew where they both were. He knew where they were. He knew that something had taken place. He knew what had taken place, church. God always knew. He knew that a gulf was created between them and him. A gulf that he himself, God, would have to bridge, you understand? That gulf that would separate him now forever. But he had to separate it. Jesus speaks of this gulf, and he speaks of it in a parable. If you'd like to turn your Bibles to Luke chapter 16, and Jesus speaks this parable of a rich man and a beggar, Lazarus. He speaks of this, and it's a parable of that gulf that has been created. In Luke chapter 16, it's a wonderful parable. In beginning in verse 19, Jesus says, "There was a certain rich man who was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day." He was a rich man. He had servants. He had everything he needed. But there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, full of sores, who laid at his gate, the rich man's gate, desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell down from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. Boy, we needed that vision, didn't we? Man, he's there, poor Lazarus. So it was that the beggar died and was carried away by the angels to Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried. And being in torment in Hades, this is the rich man, he's in torment in Hades, he lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. Then he cried out and said, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I'm tormented in this flame." But Abraham said, "Son, remember that in your lifetime you received your good things and likewise Lazarus, evil things. But now he is comforted and you are tormented." And besides all this, Abraham says, and besides all this, between us and you, there is a great gulf. A great gulf. A huge area there, and it's fixed so that those who want to pass from here to you cannot, and cannot, nor can those from there pass to us. Then he said, "I beg you, therefore, Father, that you would send him to my father's house, for I have five brothers, that he may testify to them, lest they also come to this place of torment." And Abraham said to him, they have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. They have the word of God. And they did. And he said, "No, Father Abraham, but if one goes to them from the dead, they will repent." If one goes from the dead. But he said to him, "If they do not hear Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rise from the dead." Jesus Christ. Amen. Jesus is that bridge across that gulf, guys. Jesus is the bridge. He spans a gulf. He rose from the dead. Go back to Genesis there. We're in verse 10 now. Excuse me. So he said, "I heard your voice in the garden, and I was afraid." This is Adam speaking to God. So he said, "I heard your voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself." And he said, "Who told you you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded you that you should not eat?" Then the man said, "Well, the woman, by the way, who you gave to me to be with me, she gave me of the tree and I ate. I ate it because you, God, gave me this woman." First off, sin, you see, made Adam afraid. He was hiding from God all of a sudden. He would never hide from God before. They had fellowship. But this sin, what had taken place, made Adam afraid and he hid from God. Since that time of Adam, man has hid. Man has run from God. Man has hide and they rebel against God, right? Mankind in general, they refuse to listen to God because of the sin of Adam. Refuse to be in the presence of God even. They don't want to be there so many times. He says, who told you, by the way, you're naked? God knew the answer. God knew what had taken place. Why did he ask Adam this? Think about that. Why did he ask Adam this? To allow Adam a chance for repentance. You see that right in the beginning. God said, who told you? Adam could have said, well, you know what? We ate of that fruit, and I know you told me we weren't supposed to eat of that fruit. Lord God, I am so sorry I did. No, Adam didn't do that. Of course not. He gave him the chance to make good on what had taken place. Adam did not repent. Adam chose to what? Blame another. Let's blame another. It was her. It's that one over there. That woman there you gave me, right? It's her. The one that, by the way, God, you gave her to me. Oh, he's actually blaming God at the same time. Let's blame somebody else. Everyone but me. Adam didn't repent. Not me, Lord. I just love it. I just love it. Actually, I don't. The fact of the matter is, blame that person. Blame others. Blame the authorities, you know. You know how many people I speak down to here and minister to? And, oh, it's my probation officer's fault. It's a police officer's fault. It's everybody's fault, you know. Not accepting any responsibility upon themselves. No. It's that other person. Blame that other. All and any, whoever it needs to be. Not me and not my fault. Not my heart either, you know. So many times. Where is the conflict? Where is the conflict in even the body of Christ? It's the heart, guys, of each person, you understand? Not my heart. They blame shift. Sin we own, right? That we blame on somebody else. Our own sin that we blame on others. That is not going to work in that day. What day? Well, it's called the Bema Seat of Christ. In 2 Corinthians 5:10, it'll be on the screen. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive the things done in the body, according to what he has done, whether good or bad. There's no excuse then. There is no excuse. By the way, that Bema Seat of Christ, that judgment, you are covered by the blood of Jesus in that time. There's no true judgment, but he wants to show you. You know, I think about that. Well, they go through your whole life. Oh, we got eternity. Now, I don't care how many millions of people are up there. Okay, next one to the Bema Seat of Christ. By the way, it might take 6 months. Show you everything that took place. All the good, all the bad. I don't know. How long does it take? Really doesn't matter. Fact of the matter is, there's no excuse then. No blame shifting in that day for sure. Now, God confronted Adam squarely. Have you eaten from this? Have you eaten from it? And Adam, just like many, not willing to accept his responsibility, church. The responsibility of what we have done. Not ready just to confess the sin before the Lord. You know, God's got you red-handed. He's nailed you down. Have you done this? The Holy Spirit speaking to you. And you're just running off. Not ready to confess the sin. You know, King David was a great sinner. And he owned his sin, though. One thing about David, I think that's why he was called a man after God's own heart. He owned it. You know, probably one of the greatest sins that everybody knows the story is the adulterous affair with Bathsheba and killing her husband, Uriah, and all this kind of stuff. And David, when he was met squarely and had to confess, he wrote Psalm 51, and a portion of that in verse 4. David says to God, against you, you only have I sinned and done this evil in your sight. Understand, church, first off, you might have sinned against somebody else, but first off, you sinned against God. Now, there might be a confession that needs to take place to somebody else, but you need to go to God first. He says, I've done this in your sight that you may be found just when you speak. David knew God was just in all ways and blameless when you judge. You see, David owned his sin. No, God, you know, it's Eve. Oh, by the way, it's Eve and your fault, God, right? You gave her to me. In verse 13, we read there, and the Lord God said to the woman now, he said to the woman, we're done with Adam. And the Lord God said to the woman, what is it? What is this you have done? He's blaming her. And the woman said, well, now it's the serpent deceived me and I ate. Now it's the serpent's fault. You know, let's blame that the other way. It's a serpent's fault. Eve did the exact same thing Adam did. Blame shift. Not me. It's that one over there. Points the finger at that serpent, by the way. I was deceived into sin, by the way. I was deceived. That one led me there. Guys, listen very carefully. That one led me there, she says. Don't be that one that leads somebody into sin. The scenario can be true still today. Leading others to sin, watch out. Whatever it is, you have taken them into a place that is not right and sinful before God. Matthew 18:6, Jesus says, but whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, you cause them to sin, it'd be better for him if a millstone were hung around his neck and were drowned in the depth of the sea. You guys know what a millstone is? They ground the the wheat into flour. Huge, huge stone. By the way, there might be a millstone awaiting. Watch out, guys. Be careful. Don't cause a brother or a sister to stumble. Don't lead somebody else down that path. You know, maybe it's something in your life and you just bring it into their life. There's a millstone awaiting. Verse 14. We got to move on. So the Lord God said to the serpent now. We're moving on down. We got Adam. We got Eve. Now we're moving to the serpent. And the Lord God said to the serpent, because you have done this, you are cursed more than all cattle, by the way, and more than every beast of the field. And on your belly you should go, and you shall eat dust all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. I'm going to kind of explain some of this for you here. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. You notice that capital, his, and he shall. There's a prophecy there. We'll get to that in a minute. Now, we got to notice right off the bat, when the Lord spoke to Adam and Eve, he asked them a question, right? He didn't ask Satan a question. He didn't ask that serpent one little thing. Did this actually take place? No. He didn't mess around with a conversation with Satan. What did I tell you last week? Don't have conversations with Satan. You just say, get behind me. Get behind me. Back off, Satan. You eat dirt. You know, that's where you need to belong. He didn't have no conversation with Satan at all. He asked Adam and Eve questions. No conversation was necessary, you see. He just pronounced judgment right then. You're guilty. You're going to pay the price, period. In verse 14, because you have done this, you are cursed more than all the cattle and more than every beast of the field. On your belly you shall go, and you shall eat dust all the days of your life. Can you imagine Adam and Eve? They're all together there. All right, we got Adam and Eve. We got the serpent standing there. He's on two legs at the time. And we're standing there, and Adam and Eve, their response, oh no, are we next? You know, because all of a sudden, boom, this beautiful serpent. The serpent, by the way, the serpent before God turned him into a snake was a beautiful, handsome serpent. Why do you think he went up and talked to Eve? He was standing upright. He was beautiful. Not now. He turned into a slithering snake. Are we next? You know, I can just imagine. I picture that. Them going, oh no, what's going to happen to us? This slithering snake now. eat dust, Satan. You're going to eat dust. You eat dirt, you vile deceiver. That's what God did with him. You know, Isaiah 65, 25, it speaks about, that time, basically, new heaven and new earth. It says, the wolf and the lamb shall feed together. The lion shall eat straw like an ox, and the dust shall be the serpent's food. His food doesn't change, guys. He gets to eat dust. Eat dirt, Satan. Satan comes at you, guys. Don't have a conversation, please. Just say, get behind me. Eat dust. Get below and eat that dirt, Satan. In verse 15, we read there, and I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. Now he shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. There's a second part of this curse here in verse 15, that enmity, hatred, right? The hatred that would be between basically mankind towards Satan, towards things that are evil. Enmity between man and evil. Since that time, man, whether he's been evil, he's truly hated evil. He recognized evil and he's hated that evil in a general basis, I want to say, with mankind. Between your seed and her seed, he says. Enmity, as I say, of that hatred for all mankind to come, the seed of Eve that would pass through the generations. See, Satan had always hated God. And, of course, now Satan hates God's creation, too. Why do you think he did that to them? He hated them. Now, the last part of verse 15 is a prophecy. It's prophecy of Jesus' ultimate defeat of Satan. You will bruise his heel, meaning the serpent. That's all the higher he can reach on Jesus, right? You'll get him in the heel, but guess what? Satan, God will crush your head. Jesus will crush your head, that final victory. I got a commentation here. For God to see the defeat of Satan as Satan's first flush of victory, right, when this first took place way back then, shows God knew that what he was doing all along. God's plan was not set back one little bit, church, when Adam and Eve sinned. It was not set back because God's plan was to bring forth something greater than man in the innocence of Eden. God wanted more than innocent man. His plan is to bring forth redeemed man. Redeemed man. Now we get for the penalty upon Adam and Eve. Actually, we get to see Eve first because just like today, hey, by the way, ladies first. You know, ladies first. We get to see what takes place there. Verse 16. So the woman, unto the woman, he said this, I will greatly multiply your sorrow and your conception. In pain you shall bring forth children, he says. Your desire shall be for your husband, and he shall rule over you. The penalty upon Eve will greatly multiply your sorrow, he says. Many thinks this just pertains to the childbirth, because he says that right after there. Your sorrow and your conception, in pain you shall bring forth children. Many think that's all it is that it pertains to. It's much broader than that. Church, it was much broader for the woman. The woman would be degraded, not even worth cattle. In those times back then, the woman was looked at as nothing, you see. That sorrow that would take place for women for centuries to come. They were bought and sold, you know. They probably played more for a cow than they did a woman, actually, at that time. That's what God had put the curse on. It would be degrading for women. They'd be of very little value. Now, I want to tell you, Jesus, our Lord and Savior, relieved some of this curse. Some of this curse right here. Jesus was the first women liberated women. In Galatians chapter 3, verse 27 and 28. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ and have put on Christ, you're Christians, there is neither Jew nor Greek, nor Jew nor Gentile, basically. There is neither slave nor free. There is neither male nor female. God looks at us all the same with equality. For you are all one in Christ Jesus, he says. Jesus was the first woman liberator. He set them free. I got a quote here from Barnhouse. He says, it is difficult for women in Christian lands, right, like America, to realize the miseries of their hundreds of millions of sisters in pagan lands. Go to Muslim territory. Trust me, that woman is put down. They'll trade her off. If they do any, they'll kill them. You know, a daughter goes outside of the faith, they will murder their daughter even. In these pagan lands, where the lot of women is little above that of cattle, he says, where the gospel has gone, the load has been lifted, though. You see, Jesus lifted that. Where the gospel's gone, it's been lifted, and women in Christ have become the reflection of the redeemed church, the bride of Christ. There was a greater thing of this sorrow that was going to take place for Eve. In pain now you shall bring forth childbirth. Indeed, true, true, absolutely. The human childbirth displays more pain than any others in the animal creature kingdom, I guess you'd say, right? They don't have the pain a woman has. A woman can be in labor for hours and hours, 24 hours. You know, a dog's not in that kind of pain. A cow's not in that kind of pain. No, that is true. That was the curse upon the woman. He says, now your desire shall be for your husband, and he shall rule over you. This was an inerrant challenge that was going to take place between married couples. This would always be husbands being the head, or supposed to be the head, and according to God's order, right? Head of the family, but there was always going to be that conflict. A constant desire for the woman to want to rule the husband. It was going to be hard to ever submit. That's part of the curse, guys. You know, when I do marriage counseling, and the whole thing of marriage counseling is, biblical marriage counseling is to put the marriage in God's order. It's not easy. It's not easy because of this curse right here. The woman, she rises up, right? It's not like the man is supposed to be, you know, a tyrant, but there's God's order to it. I want to read something to you. And this is, by the way, a quotation from a woman, Susan Foe, her name was. As a result of the fall, the sin, man no longer rules easily. He must fight from his headship, she says. Sin has corrupted both. I want to point this out very carefully, you men in here too. Sin has corrupted both the willing submission of the wife and the loving headship of the husband also. Sin has done that. The woman's desire is to control her husband, to usurp his divinely appointed headship, which it is. By the way, that's God's order. Don't blame me. I just read his word to you. And he must master her if he can, it says. Now that word master, that, you know, man bows to Jesus as a woman bows to Jesus. But the fact of the matter is, God has given man headship over the family. He says, so the rule of love founded in paradise is replaced by a struggle. You see, a struggle, a tyranny, and domination, she writes there. This is by a woman. The struggles of marriage have been since that time. But they can be overcome, you see. They can totally be overcome as long as it's put back into God's order. I've seen it so many times. Through God's word, you put the marriage into order, each submitting to the Lord. You know, I love my wife with all my heart, guys. But guess who's first? My Lord Jesus. I believe she loves me with all her heart. I can't speak for her, I guess, but anyway. But guess who's her first? Jesus. You understand? And so a marriage that is both looking towards the Lord is going to be a good marriage. There's still going to be struggles, though. That was part of the curse. Verse 17. We move on. Then to Adam. Oh, boy. Here we go, man. Here's what happens to Adam. He said, because you have heeded the voice of your wife and have eaten from the tree of which I commanded you, Adam, saying, you shall not eat of it. Cursed is the ground for your sake. In toil you shall eat of it all the days of your life. Both thorns and thistles it shall bring forth for you, and you shall eat the herb of the field. In the sweat of your face you shall eat bread. You're going to work your tail off, Adam. That's what God's telling him. You're going to work your tail off till you return to the ground, for out of it you were taken, for dust you are, to dust you shall return. You're going to die too. That brought death into the world because you heeded Eve's voice. See, Adam chose, he chose Eve over God even. He listened to her voice. He chose her. He heeded her and not God's word. God said, do not do it. And she said, here, take a bite. Right? He heeded Eve. Well, she was probably pretty good looking, you know. Probably better looking than God. And so he heeded her. Guys, this is the first example of idolatry. Right in the very beginning, the first example of idolatry. Putting Eve before God. Putting someone else, something else, before God. That is idolatry. Cursed is the ground, he says. Cursed is the ground. The curse literally came on all creation. Do you understand? The plants would die now. The trees would die now. Decay would happen. Things would die. All creation. The creation, the original creation, was perfect and would remain perfect. What was only good now produced weeds. You know, in that perfect garden, he didn't have to worry about a weed or a thorn. They're just that beautiful food wherever he went. And for Eve, there was that beautiful food. Now it produced weeds. Oh, there was still going to be food for them to eat, but they're going to have to deal and fight off those weeds. Anybody garden? Isn't that a bummer? And dang weeds. Where do they come from? I put in brand new soil. I've sterilized it. And a weed pops up there, man. Dang that, Adam. You know, dang. You know, I think about it. He caused, you call them goat heads, I call them bullheads. Those are the worst, nastiest little things. Well, that darn Adam, you know, he did it. The cat claw, I call it a wait-a-minute bush, right? You get, oh, wait a minute, got to get unhooked from that thing. That's a wait-a-minute bush. He caused that cat claw, all those weeds. He said, in toil you shall eat. Man was required to work and would work hard to provide for his family. By the sweat of your brow, Adam, you are going to work all the days of your life, he tells him. All the days. Retirement? No, not for you, Adam. There's no retirement. You know, a lot of people have asked me, old friends and stuff, and I have to tell them I'm a pastor now, and they said, well, did you retire from, you know, construction and doing contracting? And I said, well, you know, I'm tired. But I never learned how to retire, I guess, you know. And the fact of the matter is, truly, those who serve the Lord never really retire, guys. You understand that? I'm preaching to the choir right here. You're all servants of the Lord. You don't retire. Oh, you might have a pension, or maybe you got some Social Security coming in, or maybe you got retirement, but you're actually not retired. You're probably working harder than when you worked. Fact of the matter is, he would work sweat of his brow all the days of his life. You know, my Pastor Al used to say, Pastor Al James up in Prescott, and I'll say it too, you know, I'm going to be up here teaching God's word until I'm not. You know what I mean? Until I am no more. Maybe I'll be here and I'll peel over, all right? And then what I want you to do, number one, don't cry for me. Just pull me off here and one of these men step up and just finish the word, all right? That's all that needs to take place. In toil you shall eat. Man would work hard by the sweat of his brow all the days of his life. The principle of man providing was right here at the curse, church. Right here at this curse. I got to add this in real quick. See, where we are as a nation today, where we are is really as a world, but it's more so, we see it in America greatly, European nations also. Why we see such a degrading of the family? Why do we see such a degrading of the family, you know? Dads that aren't dads, they're not there anymore. Single moms, maybe single dads, family broken, all this kind of stuff. Why? Because the woman took on the curse of the man. It was never the woman's job to do the work. It was Adam's job. She was to be a helpmate. She was to take care of the family. She was to be that for Adam, but not going to the workplace. Guys, where's the number one place that adultery takes place? At the workplace. You know, she says something to him. His wife doesn't say those things. Well, pretty soon, there it is. Or the other way around, right? See, the man, the woman was took on the curse of the man. And that's out of God's order. And so what do you see with society? It went down. Take it or leave it. I believe that to be the truth. The final part that he told Adam, death, dust you are, and dust you will return. Sin brought death into the world. Not God's original plan, by the way. Oh, he knew it would be, but it wasn't really the original plan. The sin of Adam extended to all mankind, and death. Death would take place. Guys, turn to Romans. We're going to wind it down here real quick. At least I hope so. In Romans chapter 5, Paul writes about this extensively, this one man, what took place. Romans chapter 5, verse 12. I got to move on. Therefore, just as through one man sin entered the world, he's speaking of Adam, and death through sin, and thus death spread to all men, because all are sinners, all sinned, he says. For until the law, sin was in the world, but sin is not imputed where there is no law. Let me explain that just really quick, really simply. From the time of Adam to Moses, right, sin still happened. But then the law of God came through Moses, and it was directed as what that sin really was. And that's what that verse speaks about right there. Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over those who had not sinned according to the likeness of the transgressions of Adam, who is a type of him. Adam is a type of Jesus, who was to come. But the free gift is not like the offense. For if one man's offense, many died. Much more, the grace of God and the gift by the grace of the one man, Jesus Christ, now abounded to many, Paul says. And the gift is not like that which comes through the one who sinned, no. For the judgment which come from one offense resulted in condemnation of man. Condemnation. But the free gift which came from many offenses, resulted in justification. There again, through our Lord. For if by one man's offense death reigned through the one, much more those who receive abundance of grace and of the gift of the righteousness will reign in life through the one, Jesus Christ, you see. Now he carries on. Boy, Paul, he says, I want you to get this. Therefore, as through one man's offense, judgment come to all men, resulting in condemnation, even so through one man's righteous act, the free gift come to all men, resulting in justification of life. For by one man's disobedience, many were made sinners, so also by one man's obedience to the cross, obedience to the Father, many will be made righteous. Amen. See, Adam's sin brought death. Jesus' sacrifice brought life, eternal life, church. Life eternal through one man, one God-man in reality, the Son of God, by the grace of God, too. The grace we have, Ephesians 2, beginning in verse 8, For by grace you have been saved through faith, through belief. It is the grace of God. You don't deserve it. And neither do I, by the way. It's God's grace. And that of not of yourself, it is a gift of God, it says. Not of works, lest anyone should boast. We can't earn it. We can't. You know, if you're trying to earn your way to heaven, just receive the grace of God. Believe in Jesus. But with that grace, church, I believe it does come a responsibility. It really does. To walk in that grace. Would you walk in the grace, please, that God has given you in Jesus? Walk in it. Receive it. Don't shine it on. And then see what God has a plan for you in Ephesians 2:10. It says there, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works. We are God's creation. And we're created in Christ Jesus for these good works, which God, by the way, prepared beforehand for each and every one of you, that we should walk in them, walk in the grace, and walk in God, what God has prepared for you out there. Step in faith, man. God's prepared a work for each and every one of us. He has. And many of you, like I say, I'm preaching to the choir. The fact of the matter is, you step in that faith. But walk in God's grace, not that cursed sin, right? Oh, you wonder where the title was going to come back. Not that cursed sin. Walk in what he has prepared, not in our flesh. Amen? Let's pray. Father God, we just thank you, Lord. Thank you for your word, Jesus. God, your word is so powerful, Lord. Lord, through that one man, we had received salvation, that God man, Jesus Christ. Lord, we are all sinners. We all fall short of the glory of God. But Jesus, you make us clean, white as snow, Lord. We just thank you. We praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.